When we first meet Rose Zimmer of Queens, New York, she's about to be kicked out of the Communist Party. The year is 1955, and as events unfold through many decades, we get a multi-generational story of one slice of American life, a constant mix of the personal and the political. It's all part of the new novel Dissident Gardens by author Jonathan Lethem, whose previous novels include Chronic City and The Fortress of Solitude. Welcome to you.
Thanks for having
me. It's interesting because I said it's a big multi-generational look at one slice, but it started, I gather, with you wanting to write about your own grandmother?
Yeah, it's absolutely the source for the book was contemplating all the kind of dark areas in my experience of my grandmother's life, that I knew she'd had a gigantic political existence in the 30s and 40s and 50s, and yet all of this was sort of sealed in silence by the time I came along.
You didn't know any of it, and so you learn later.
Well, of course, I didn't actually ever have access to her dossier, if such a thing exists. I think maybe it does. But I'm a novelist, so my license is to go and make it all up.
Well, how did it grow? I mean, it become, and when did you know that it was this big story?
There are, you know, I may not have my grandmother's story, but the lives of radicals in the 20th century, it's a giant part of the American story, a very complicated, turbulent, sometimes tragic one, but it involves areas of a great triumph and accomplishment as well. And I had all sorts of places to go for that. Memoirs, accounts, you know, Irving Howe, Vivian Gornick, the memoirs by Red Diaper Babies, mm-hmm. you know, basically were my bread and butter.
Well, it's a small, almost kind of closed, somewhat paranoid group that you're writing about, American communists and sympathizers. We look back, and you know, part of it, as I'm reading, it almost looks quaint in a way, but then it was quite serious. I mean,
it was more than serious. It was strongly influential, I think, on the shape of pre-war American life as anything could be. And you know, one of the things that I concluded, this book isn't a historiography; it's really about the characters. But I realized these were very American choices to make, very typical in their way, that we are a country made up of waves of different kinds of utopian ambition and aspiration, and that this was one of those.
And sometimes, as you're getting into it here, that ambition and utopianism becomes a kind of certitude that has bad consequences.
Well, we've got plenty of that going around at the moment, right?
As we sit here.
A utopian ambition that hardens into a kind of oppositional or paranoid certitude or almost a violent kind of oppositional position.
So your job as a novelist is to put flesh on the personal side of that.
That, for me, is always where the job is really centered, is what was it like to live these lives, you know, to feel my way in. Other people can do history. I'm not qualified, and I'm not really, in a way, inclined that way. I wanted to make you feel that these lives really existed and what they consisted of.
And how they touched each other, right? Because we start with Rose, and then her daughter has a different sort of political activism,
yeah.
and then her son.
Well, and I did want to say this isn't a story that ends. That actually, you know, and of course, right as I was beginning to write the book, the Occupy movement sort of erupted, and I felt, okay, this has got to get into this story too, because it's not something that's just sealed up in history. It's a part, this radical tradition is a part, even if it is often kind of subliminal, it's a part of our life as a country.
Part of it, I was thinking about the personal side of it. It's different ways of setting oneself apart from society.
Absolutely.
Or in opposition to this.
In opposition, and yet here we are, this gigantic history, this gigantic society, this gigantic nation, made up of people so often who believe themselves to be working into the center from some margin, whether it's an immigrant position or some other kind of ambition or dream that, you know, creates a kind of subculture. I felt the communists were working from the outside, but they were deeply engaged with the idea of the American story.
You know, the last time we talked about your last novel, Chronic City, we talked about, I remember, your love of comic books and detective novels and science fiction and how you often got that into the stories. This one, not so much, right?
Well, I do. I guess I see human lives often in cultural terms. And I do write about the folk music scene here.
Yes.
And in some ways, that's as large a sway on these characters as, you know, rap music and comic books have on the characters in the late 70s in The Fortress of Solitude. I think my characters, the kind of people I know and the kind of people, honestly, that I come from, define themselves culturally. You know, the kinds of music, the kinds of clothing, the kinds of attitudes, literature, these are the ways that they name who they are and how they feel.
But what's not here is the sort of fantastic. I mean, there was that tiger walking
right
through the streets of Manhattan before. And when we talked last, because you said, and I wrote it down, you always want to get the real world on the page, but then distort it.
Yeah.
This story is a little, it's not quite distort. Well, you're a novelist, right? So you're taking the facts and running with them.
Yeah, there are distortions, of course. I give myself all kinds of license. And in my mind, there is, in a way, a fantastic element in this story, too. The fantasy is ideology. Mm-hmm. It's what happens when inchoate political feeling or utopian yearning are taken and made into a kind of a concept, and people begin living their lives according to that concept. What could be more fantastical than that?
You were just talking earlier about your job as a writer. Put any particular book aside. When you sit, do you have a conception at this point, having written a number of them, of what your job is as a novelist?
Well, I think that it's a job that invents itself over and over again. My job, in a way, is to abide with my own curiosity, my own ignorance, and reach out into that space, as I did with my grandmother's life, and as I did here with the 1930s and the 40s, places I haven't been, can't go back and visit, and just dream my way into other lives as well as I can.
Dream your way into other lives. That's it.
That's it.
All right, the new novel is Dissident Gardens. Jonathan Lethem, thanks for talking to us.
Thank you.